Cool. Good morning, everyone. How you doing? My name is Brian Farnhill, and this short little session is around improvements to the business connectivity services in SharePoint 2013. So just a little bit about myself before we get started in here. I'm an independent consultant. I'm based out of Canberra, one of the few people who thinks that living in the nation's capital is a good idea. But I'm SharePoint Server MVP, have been for the last few years, and I'm also a part-time lecturer for Charles Sturt University. So the guys have got a booth around here, and I'm teaching a topic for them around SharePoint 2013 development as part of their postgraduate degree for Masters of Software Development. So if you're studying at that level, worth stopping and having a chat to them at the booth. But shameless plugs aside, let's get into what we're talking about. So just a quick introduction to the BCS for anyone who's not familiar with it. The Business Connectivity Services is basically designed to allow you to bring data from remote sources into SharePoint. Right? It showed up originally in SharePoint 2007 as a read-only thing, primarily to boost like search and being able to index data that was outside of SharePoint. With 2010, though, they added the ability for it to be a two-way thing, so we could update data in remote sources and then work as SharePoint being a portal to be able to manipulate values that are outside of what's actually stored in SharePoint. So there are a bunch of good reasons for going and using the BCS, and also as developers, it makes a lot of sense for us to look at using the BCS when trying to connect to external systems rather than connecting directly. The benefits include being able to have a centralized infrastructure to manage connections. So take this scenario. If I've got a SQL database and I need to give users permission to update rows in that SQL database, I could give them permissions directly at SQL and let them do it that way. But in theory, at that point, they could directly manipulate the database because they have permissions to do so. If I'm using the BCS, I could set up appropriate entities in there so that they can come to SharePoint and edit the data through there and not give them permissions directly to the database. I could tell that to go through the secure store service or some other source of credentials and to make the calls to the database that way. So it allows me to centralize some things around my authentication. We do get a set of common interfaces for being able to access data in the BCS. All right, so the benefit here is that accessing BCS data programmatically in SharePoint, whether you're working server-side or client-side, it's done in exactly the same way as just accessing a SharePoint list. So you take out the need to understand exactly how a specific external system works and just start working with it like it's a list, which makes life easier for us as developers in that regard. Like I said, we get indexing of data, which is a great way to bring information into SharePoint and into its search. And yeah, like I said, we don't need to learn how to access every single external system that we have in our enterprise. We can just manage it all through the BCS centrally. So with a pretty diagram, that's basically how it looks. We have a number of different connectors to be able to connect to things through the BCS. There's the out-of-the-box SQL connector. There's the web service connector. There's the ability to write custom .NET connectors. And basically, they all go out, access these systems, bring it in through the BCS, and can surface it up to all sorts of things. Just regular lists is a go-to one, search, but we can refer to them in columns, like lookup columns, things like that. The user profile importer is also another really good use of the BCS in that I can map specific fields in the user profile to something that's come from an external system, like a HR system or something to that extent. All right, so all sorts of useful ways to use BCS. So what's different with the BCS in SharePoint 2013? There's been a really big focus on getting BCS to work in the cloud. Right? So SharePoint 2013 overall, there's been a lot of changes to be able to facilitate this move to the cloud and Office 365. And as developers, we pick up a lot of those benefits on-premise as well. There's been support added for notification of external events. All right, and I'll get to that in a minute as well. And lastly, we can include BCS content types inside of apps. So show of hands, who's familiar with the new app model inside of SharePoint? Excellent. Everyone who didn't put your hand up, come to my session later today where we're talking about apps. But basically, we've got the ability to create these little standalone apps that can be deployed through the App Store, and they can actually include custom BCS connectors. Right? And I'm going to demonstrate that a little bit later. So talking about the cloud and BCS and what we can do there, Office 365 has, since probably halfway through the 2010 lifecycle, has had support for the WCF connector. So you've been able to create BCS entities in the cloud before using WCF as the interface. With SharePoint 2013, we've added a new interface, and it's based on OData. So show of hands, who's familiar with OData then? OData is basically a way of being able to query over HTTP using the query string to specify what fields we want, how we're going to filter, how we're going to sort, that sort of thing. So the ability to have these OData connectors is one of the primary additions to the BCS for SharePoint 2013. But the reason that we have just the OData and WCF connectors in the cloud is purely around they are the two that translate most easily to a remote scenario. And that's because they both rely on HTTP and HTTPS as their communication methods. If I was to say to Microsoft, I want you to open up ports to get to SQL servers externally from Office 365, they would probably point and laugh at me and tell me to go home. But over HTTP, we're not going to run into issues with firewalls or anything like that, so they've incorporated those into the cloud. It's also worth noting that Office 365 also has access to the secure store service. All right, so we can still define specific credentials for our external calls through the secure store service in the cloud. And both the BCS and the secure store service, as far as Office 365 is concerned, are managed at a per tenant level. So anytime I'm creating custom BCS entities for my tenant, they go across all site collections that I've got access to there. So external events. This is a new one for SharePoint 2013. Basically, what they've added is that the ability for SharePoint to subscribe to notifications from your external system. So this means that, say you've got a custom application that is updating things that you've got connected as a BCS entity. That loud voice is really talking over me, isn't it? Okay, so say you've got an external system and you're connecting to that. You could have it be able to push notifications into SharePoint to say, I've just updated this row. Now, the reason this is important is that I can have people create remote event receivers and other event receivers within SharePoint so that SharePoint becomes the hub for triggering out events to external systems. So in this way, as long as your system can talk to SharePoint and say, hey, this row has been updated, anyone else who needs to tie into your system and know about that can do so by connecting through to SharePoint. All right, so this means they don't need to know about your specific system, they just need to know how to write event receivers for SharePoint, because it's all done in exactly the same way. There are some issues with this approach, though, in that you need to make sure that your external system, if it doesn't get through to SharePoint, to say, hey, this is updated, that you're going to have some sort of mechanism to ensure guaranteed delivery. Because otherwise, if you've got other systems hanging off of SharePoint for event receivers and SharePoint doesn't get word that that row got updated because the connection was down or something like that, then you're going to have some data integrity issues. But the model's been added, and it's sort of interesting to look at from a theoretical standpoint, if nothing else. So SharePoint apps, in 2013 apps. One of the things that we can do with this is we can include external content types inside of these, which is a fantastic way to start incorporating remote applications into a SharePoint hosted app in particular. Now, there are a couple of dot points here to consider with this. The only type of connector you can use inside of an app is the OData connector. All right, I can't use WCF, I can't use any of the other ones, it has to be the OData connector. The reasoning for this is that if you actually look at the architecture for what a SharePoint app can do and how it can talk to an external system, it does this through basically using the SP request executor and SharePoint acting as like a proxy of sorts to go talk to the other things. So you could actually do that in code yourself in JavaScript out of the box. So adding the OData connector was not a whole big bit of a jump there. The WCF stuff, they've ruled that out and saying that the OData is the way to go forward here. It's probably a more scalable model, and the OData stuff is actually really quite nice once you start digging into it. The other thing worth mentioning as well is that you can only add one specific connector, one definition, into an app. So this means that you can call that to one OData service. There might be multiple entities and multiple things going on inside of that, but you can only have that one service inside of an app. So another consideration there. So just introducing what OData was for those who weren't familiar. It's basically HTTP-based protocol for doing all CRUD operations over HTTP. So we can be able to request data, and that's quite often where the BCS makes use of it. Also makes use of REST from a URI perspective as well, and that will structure our URLs. And particularly if you look at the client-side endpoints inside of SharePoint 2013, you'll see that both REST and OData, how they're implemented in those client-side endpoints. So if we want to go and create OData endpoints inside of our apps for SharePoint 2013, and this is where I'm going to focus my demo on here because it's the biggest new area for us. It's not supported in SharePoint Designer, and I actually don't know a good reason why they left it out of SharePoint Designer, because it is so alarmingly simple. You can do it in Visual Studio, and when you're building your apps out there, and it literally takes about 5 seconds to do. Right, there's a little wizard you walk through, and it sets it all up for you. Little to no managed code needs to be written for this type of connector. So the demo I've got today is zero managed code at all. Right, it's SharePoint hosted app, no JavaScript or anything, just literally, here's the definition, here's the list. And Visual Studio does all the hard work for us, which is fantastic. All right, so now let's move off into a demo, and I'll show you guys some of this stuff. Excellent. All right, so Visual Studio, this is 2012, and basically what I want to do is I'm going to create a new OData entity that points to the Northwind OData endpoint that's a sample on odata.org. So I've built an app out already that's going to go and do this, and just to give you guys a quick look at what it does first, and then I'll walk through how it's built, we'll just press F5 and run this up. So you see I'm loading a list of videos. Actually, I lied, this is not the Northwind demo, this is the Telerik demo. Telerik have an OData endpoint on their website that lists all the videos that they have on their TV channel. And so what I'm using is that as an example to pull those in. So you can see here I've got a list of all these videos, and if I go clicking on the links, it goes and opens up the website there off to their thing. So I've done all of this within a SharePoint hosted app using the BCS as a way of accessing that external data. So let's have a look at how that actually works. So inside of my SharePoint app package, you can see I've got a folder here called External Content Types. And inside of that, I've got my videos list. So I'm creating that as an external list. So if you've ever worked with the BCS before, the premise here is still the same. I'm still creating an external content type. It's connected to an external list. And the behavior is very, very much the same. The difference here is just how easy it is to create that. All right, so what I'm going to do quickly is I'm just going to open up a new project and just show you how quick it is to get that entity in there. All right, so give me a new project, app for SharePoint. Yep, deploy it there, SharePoint hosted. Let's grab the URL of my endpoint. Come on. I like loading bars. How about you guys? There we go. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to right-click on my project and say I want to add. And you'll see here there's an option now in a SharePoint hosted app that says content types for external data source. It's listed in the menu here specifically. All right, so if we call out to that, give it the URL of my endpoint, and I'm going to call it Telerik again. It goes away, checks the endpoint to figure out what entities are there. So in this case, I'm saying I want the videos. You'll also see that there's an option at the bottom that says, do you want to automatically create list instances? All right, so it's going to set those up, do all the wiring to say this is an external list, points off to that, and set that up for us. And click finish. That's literally it. There's my external content type set up with an external list based off the OData endpoint. Really, really easy to do. So the next step now that we've got that set up is how do we actually go about querying that data? So I'm running a SharePoint hosted app. I've got JavaScript in my pages and I need to be able to get that data back out. So let's close this new app off and go back to the one I prepared earlier and have a look into my JavaScript. So what we have here for anyone who's not familiar with this is I'm making a REST call. So I'm not using the managed JavaScript object model. I'm using just native REST calls, using jQuery to make the call. So the first thing I do is I build up my URL. Now let me just scroll across here so you can see that URL in full. Oops, that's not it. That one. So the underscore API directory, this is where all of the client-side endpoints are accessed from in SharePoint 2013. It's actually a map that goes back to the client.svc service that was the endpoint in SharePoint 2010. But you can see here, I'm actually building up a REST-based query by saying lists, get by title, videos, items. So for anyone who's looked at the client-side endpoints in 2013, this is exactly the same mechanism for querying a list in our site. Right? So the fact that it's an external list is completely transparent to me at this point. I've got some OData selectors on the end there to specify which of the fields I want back, just to trim down the result set to just the fields I'm using. Yep, so the question there for anyone who didn't hear it was just clarifying that the user's browser will talk via JavaScript to SharePoint, and SharePoint will go and make the REST call out to the OData endpoint. Yes, that is exactly how it works. And what I'll do here in a second is I'll open Fiddler and I'll show you that it's only talking to SharePoint, right? But you see, so there's my URL. Just a standard AJAX request using jQuery to go and make the call there. So using the GET, requesting that I want JSON data back is my response. And then basically my on success, just because I built this one out in a hurry, I'm just building a chunky HTML string together. Normally I'd like to use something like Knockout or one of the other JavaScript frameworks for building UI up here. But basically I'm just spitting it all out to the page based on my the properties of, that I'm getting, and off it goes. So just for the question there, run Fiddler up and go and run this demo again. So loading the videos from the remote location. So you see the only calls that have happened here between the browser and from the browser are calls directly to my app URL. Right? So the calls that SharePoint are making are obviously being made by the service account in a different context, which is why they're not showing up inside of Fiddler here. But it will go and make those calls for you. Now, this means you need to keep in mind that there are scenarios where you might not get data back. For example, if SharePoint is unable to reach that OData service, it will return an error back to you, and you need to be able to handle that. But this is a general approach to how we should be doing our client-side apps anyway. You know, on the server side, we got away with being lazy for many, many years, right? We could always assume that everything was going to be there because we were running right on top of where SharePoint was. Now we're running in a disconnected model where communication isn't always guaranteed, right? So our applications need to be able to handle that. In the circumstance where the endpoint becomes unavailable, it'll actually spit you out a really big JSON object back with it's got exception details. It will also give you correlation IDs, all right? So because in this case, it's the BCS that's making the call from the server, there will be an entry that goes into the ULS logs that says, here's why I couldn't get to that service. So it'll give you a correlation ID in that JSON response that you can use to go and troubleshoot from that end. All right, so we do still get meaningful data back despite the fact that we are running remotely and going through SharePoint as a proxy there. Right. But that's basically it. So if we go through and just have a look quickly at the actual external content type, and just open it up with XML. For anyone who's looked at a definition of a BCS entity before, you'll see the XML structure is pretty much the same. The main difference here is the type of OData. So we're just specifying some different properties in there, but essentially it's all still done the same. We still provide the same functions against the stereotype methods for finder, specific finder, all that sort of thing. It's just that SharePoint generates it all for us because it knows how OData behaves. Right? So it doesn't need to ask you a billion questions about how it's going to communicate, what it's going to do. It says, I know OData, I can work with that. Right? So it makes it really, really easy to bring this sort of stuff into SharePoint. Okay, so... so that's about all I wanted to run through with you guys this morning. And just wanted to give you guys some points that hopefully you can take away and go and do from this. Install a SharePoint 2013 SDK. Right, you don't actually need a full SharePoint environment to go and run this up in. Right? The SDK is available through the web platform installer. And if you sign up for Office 365, you can sign up for a developer site collection and deploy your apps directly to that. You don't need to build a SharePoint VM to be able to build apps for SharePoint, which is amazing. So go and grab the SDK. For those of you who don't know about OData, definitely go in and have a look into that. There's all sorts of information and resources at odata.org. That you can use to start understanding how that works. And start playing around with the BCS entities inside of your SharePoint hosted apps. Like I said, it makes a really great way to be able to access these external sources and simplify the code you've got to write to be able to do so. So those are my contact details for anyone who wants to get a hold of me. Email address there is brian@brianfarnhill.com. I'm at Brian Farnhill on Twitter. And my blog there is blog.brianfarnhill.com. And related content... more related to this one and also probably my other session today, the building app business applications with K2. We're talking about SharePoint apps and how K2 built their apps out. So a lot of things about the SharePoint hosted and provider hosted apps there. So that's tomorrow afternoon right before the party. And also not on this slide is I've got a session later today at 1:45 with Alex Burton from Nintex, where we're going to be talking about SharePoint and Office apps and going from the creation through to publishing and the entire process there and what's involved with the App Store as well. So if you're interested in catching up with me, I'll be around there. Would love to hear your feedback on the session as well. We're not above buying your feedback, so we're giving away prizes there for the sculpt mouse. And the usual resources there, Channel 9 and MSDN, if you're developers, you're probably already familiar with. But yeah, so before I wrap up, did anyone want to throw any other questions at me about this? need to yell. Yep, so the OData stuff can write back to the source, assuming you've got permissions to do so, right? So you can use secure store service to set up credentials for who can go back to the source there, but it just does the same sorts of things in using REST and the specifically the HTTP method, so get, post, update, delete, that sort of thing, but it does support all of that, yes. Other questions? Yep. So yeah, the question was if I've got an auto-hosted app and running a WCF service that's there and you want to create a BCS, BCS entity to that, you can. You just need to specify the remote app web URL. There's a token for that, and it'll get substituted in at runtime. So whenever that URL changes, you're ready to go. Okay, cool. If there's no other questions, thank you guys for coming. Hope you enjoyed the session, and hope you enjoy TechEd. Thank you.